Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Oh, it's great to be back with you. Great to see everybody here. How's everybody doing? Excellent. Excellent. I heard mostly good, so I'll take it. The rain is a good day to be inside and worship here together, so I'm glad to see all of you. The only announcement that I have this morning is that the Z Youth are gearing up for their mission trip this summer. And so if you want to support them, swing by the dock overhang this Thursday. As part of Thursdays on Main, they're going to be offering some Culvers. So if you want to grab some Culvers to munch on, Thursday is your day to do it. So for Thursdays on Main, this Thursday, swing by the dock and help support the kids as they gear up for their mission trip this summer. Other than that, I wanted to just mention that the first hymn that we're going to sing as part of our opening worship, we're diving into a slightly different hymnal this morning. So it's only going to be on the screen. So don't you worry, it's still going to be on the screen for you to follow along with. But if you're flipping through the hymnal going, I don't see it anywhere. What's going on? Don't panic. We've got you covered. But with that, would you stand? Let's greet one another and let's worship together.
Great is thy faithfulness.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us take a moment of silence for reflection and self-examination. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks. We praise you for your glory, Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father. Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer, for you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit, in the glory.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of heaven and earth, before the foundation of the universe and the beginning of time, you are the triune God, author of creation, eternal word of salvation, life-giving spirit of wisdom. Guide us to all truth by your Spirit, that we may proclaim all that Christ has revealed and rejoice in the glory he shares with us. Glory and praise to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first lesson is from the sixth chapter of Isaiah, beginning with verse 1.
In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered the face, with two wings they covered their feet, and with two wings they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it, he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched his lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And he said, "Here I am, send me."
Today's responsive reading is from Psalm 29. Let us read it responsively by half verse. Ascribe to the Lord, you heavenly beings.
Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders.
The Lord thunders over the mighty waters.
The voice of the Lord is powerful.
The voice of the Lord is majestic.
The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars.
The Lord breaks in pieces the cedars of Lebanon.
He makes Lebanon leap like a calf.
Sharon like a young old wife.
The voice of the Lord strikes
with flashes of lightning.
The voice of the Lord shakes the desert.
The Lord shakes the desert.
The voice of the Lord twists the oaks and strips the forests bare. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood.
The Lord is enthroned as a king forever.
The Lord gives strength to his people. The second lesson is from the second chapter of Acts, beginning with verse 14.
Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. "Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourself know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknown, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it is impossible for death to keep its hold on him. David said about him, 'I saw the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest in hope.'"
Here ends the reading.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the third chapter.
Glory to you,
Lord. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." "How can someone be born when they are old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, 'You must be born again.' The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." "How can this be?" Nicodemus asked. "You are Israel's teacher," Jesus said. "And do you not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and we testify to what we have seen, but still, you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you. Thank you.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Well, good morning. If you're new with us, you're just joining us, or you're joining us online, my name is John Hoppel, and I'm the Traditional Service Director here at Zion. And today we're finishing up our series that we've been in for the last several weeks, Heaven and Hell and Everything in Between. And so today we're going to conclude this series, wrap everything up by talking about the coming day that we are all waiting for. The thing that we as Christians are clinging to, the hope that we have, and that day is Judgment Day. The day we stand before our Creator. Before we dive into this, I have a couple of passages I want to read today. First, from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. He writes these words, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad." And the second from the book of Revelation, chapter 20. "The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy are those who share in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them, but they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. And then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death, and anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire." So this idea of Judgment Day, a day when all people will stand before the Lord, King Jesus, and give an account of their life, this idea can be scary for a lot of people. It can be uncomfortable for a lot of people. Jesus and the disciples regularly taught and warned about this day when Jesus would return to judge the living and the dead. Jesus taught many parables about the kingdom of heaven and its coming. And he warned many times to be ready. Be on watch, be on guard, for you do not know the day nor the hour when I'm coming back. Here are just a few of these warnings that Jesus gave about Judgment Day. In Matthew 12, Jesus confronts the Pharisees about this day. Matthew 12, verse 35 says this, "A good man brings good things out of the good stored up in him, and an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in him. But I tell you that everyone will have to give account on the day of judgment for every empty word that they have spoken. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned." Think about that. Every person is going to give an account for every empty, every foolish, every harmful word they have ever spoken. Ugh. Okay, well, I don't know about you, but I've said some foolish things, some hurtful things. I've said things that I wish that I could take back. We know that words have power. They can hurt those around us if we're not careful. But Jesus says, look, your words can hurt you too. Your words will be against you. And earlier, in Matthew chapter 7, we read these difficult words from Jesus. Matthew chapter 7, verse 21. "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles?' Then I will tell them plainly, 'I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers.'" Now, personally, I've never driven out a demon, and I've never performed any miracles, so if these people aren't qualified, what chance do I have? Uh-oh. What chance do most of us have? However, people will try to justify their lives with religious acts. Jesus, Lord, I went to church every day. Every week I was in church. I read my Bible every day. I even prophesied in your name. And Jesus will say, depart from me. I never knew you. Jesus is saying that what saves you is not your religious deeds, no matter how great or small they are, or even the things you do in the name of Jesus. What matters is the status of your relationship with Jesus. Does he know you? Do you know him? I'm not just talking about knowledge of Jesus. I'm not just talking about the facts that you might pick up along the way. Oh, yeah, I know Jesus. He fed 5,000 people one time with fish and bread, I think. And then there was that time when he raised some people from the dead. That was pretty cool. And I guess he died and rose again himself, and that's about it. That's all I know. Jesus wants to know you, to really know you, to have a relationship with you. What is the status of your relationship with Jesus? Do you belong to Jesus? Do you love him? Do you love him enough to trust and obey him? Finally, we get these words from Paul in 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians 4, chapter 4, verse 5. Therefore, judge nothing before the appointed time. Wait until the Lord comes. He will bring to light what is hidden in darkness and will expose the motives of the heart. At that time, each will receive their praise from God. See, the hidden things in our lives will be revealed on Judgment Day. Paul and Jesus are alluding to the fact that nothing will be hidden from God when we stand before him. Nothing will be hidden from God, period. He's not surprised by anything we do. He isn't looking down at us from heaven each and every day going, whoa, didn't expect that. No, he knows. He knows. But on that day, everything that we have said, everything that we have done will be brought to light. There won't be anything to hide behind. No excuses, no mask, no face, nothing. We've talked before about the difficult question Christians get asked. Why don't good people go to heaven? Why does it seem like God says, well, it's not about being good? Well, just because something looks good on the outside doesn't mean it's good on the inside. Sometimes it's easy to see a sin. Sometimes it's easy to see people who are struggling with sin, because it's very obvious. Some are. Some are easy to see. Some are easy to pinpoint and go, oh, I see they're struggling with this. But don't be fooled. Don't be fooled into thinking that just because you look good, just because your sin isn't on display, that you are actually as good as you think you are. That there isn't something that you're trying to hide or cover up. Because on that day, we won't be able to. We will stand before our Creator who knows us better than we know ourselves. If your thoughts were broadcast for all to hear, would they think the same about you? If your life, your entire life, moment by moment, day by day, was played out on a screen like a movie, would you invite people to watch? None of us would come out looking very good, would we? Proverbs 21:2 says, every way of a man is right in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the heart. Back in the Old Testament, a prophet of God's by the name of Samuel was tasked to go and appoint the new king of the nation of Israel that God had pointed out. And so he goes to this family. The dad comes out. His name's Jesse. He says, well, I got some sons for you. Here's my firstborn. I'll bring him over here. Come on over, son. Here's a prophet from the Lord. He's anointing a new king. And Samuel goes, ah, this guy, this son, he is strong. He is strapping. He is ready to go. This is a leader if ever I've seen one. And God says, not him. Okay? Well, send out the next one, I guess. And one by one, each of these sons comes out. And God says, not that one. Not that one, not that one. And pretty soon, the entire roster is expended. There's nobody left. And Samuel says, sorry, this is a bit awkward. Do you have any more sons by chance? And Jesse says, well, I have one more. He's out in the field watching the sheep. And he calls his last son David, who doesn't look the part. And yet God says, him. I want you to anoint him. He's going to be the king over my people. And Samuel says, I mean, you're God, but are you sure? Are you sure about this? He doesn't look the part. And God says, I don't judge by what's on the outside. I look at what's in your heart. It's easy for us to look the part. It's very easy to look the part. I probably look the part right now. Look at this. I got a robe on. I got this cool sash. I got a mic. I'm standing at the pulpit. I look the part, right? I look the part. But the message I preach to myself is that God looks at the heart and wants to really know who you are, no matter what you look like. On Judgment Day, God will bring to light everything that has been hidden, including what people have been able to hide from others. And if you look at just these verses, as we read them, you might be sitting here going, oh boy, this is uncomfortable. I don't like this. These verses are heavy and can be depressing. And you might feel hopeless when you read this. But for those who belong to Jesus, Judgment Day is good news. It isn't something to be afraid of, but something to look forward to. The question we have to ask ourselves is, am I living my life set apart for Jesus, by Jesus, with Jesus, here and now? In the book of Acts, after Jesus has risen from the dead and met with his disciples, he took them outside the city for one last gathering. Acts chapter 1, verse 7, Jesus said to them, it is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And after he had said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid them from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven. In that moment, the disciples missed the point, like so many do. They stood, what does it say? They stood waiting, looking up for Jesus. I just imagine that, first of all, this is probably the first time they've seen somebody levitate all the way up into the sky and vanish into the clouds. So they probably just looked like, just standing there with their mouths open, can't believe what they're seeing. And even after Jesus is gone, I imagine they stood there for a good several minutes, just waiting for Jesus maybe to pop back down and say, oh, one more thing. They stood waiting. And Jesus and the angel's challenge is the same challenge for us today. Stop waiting. Go in the power of the Holy Spirit and be his witness. Go. In his book, Just Do Something, Pastor and author Kevin DeYoung highlights the importance of living our lives for Christ, but warns us not to simply wait around for God's direction and revelation. If we sit in this place of spiritual indecision, we can miss the good things that God has for us here and now, today. And I know that I've been guilty of wanting God to directly and clearly answer my prayers with guidance and purpose. I wanted a divine text message from God. I wanted Him to say, here's what I need you to do. Go here, do this. Thus saith the Lord. Cool, thanks. Send. But that is rarely how God chooses to guide us. When we sit and literally wait on the Lord to tell us exactly what to do, or focus heavily on the things to come we have little control over, we can miss out on today. Kevin DeYoung writes these words in his book: if we had done something, almost anything really, faithfully and humbly for God's glory for all that time, we could have made quite an impact. But if we do nothing, because we are always trying to figure out the perfect something, when it comes time to show what we did for the Lord, we will not have anything at all. See, this judgment day isn't something to be afraid of. It's a challenge for us who believe. It's a challenge for those who want to live their lives for Jesus. It's a challenge to live each day for God. How do we know if we truly belong to Jesus? Well, those who truly belong to Jesus confess and repent of their sin regularly. They want Jesus more than they want the sin in their life, the sin that they may have even hidden away, that is unseen by maybe everybody except for God. Number two, they confess Jesus as Lord, not just of the world, but of their life. He has the final say over their life. And finally, they love and they worship Jesus. They want to give ultimate worth to Jesus in all of their life, not just for a few hours, maybe on a Sunday morning. Now, I want to be clear, we're not going to do this perfectly. We will not always live our lives like this. We will sin. We will succumb to temptation, but Jesus is our Savior as well as our Lord. So when we stand before the throne of God, we will have our deeds, our words written there, displayed before everybody, but instead of them being against us, instead of them being something we have to fear, the blood of Christ will blot out our sins. They'll be gone, paid for, washed away. Our words, our deeds will all be laid bare for everyone to see, but they will no longer condemn us because we place our hope and trust in Christ. We'll be able to stand before God confidently and say, I'm with Him. I'm with Him, Jesus. We will have a relationship with Him. We abide with Him. As the hymn says, when before the throne I stand in Him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all. Jesus paid it all. On judgment day, all will be judged. But those who are in Christ will have their sins forgiven. Those who have chosen to follow Him will enter into eternal life. And as for those who do not wish to follow Christ, all of their sins, their words, their deeds, the things that they have tried to ignore or hidden or covered up, they'll be revealed for everyone to see. They'll be counted against them. And more than that, death and even Hades will be cast out as well. Death, as we know it, will no longer be a force in this world. It's gone, cast out, not in here. Hades, as in that day, was known as the place where the dead resided, almost a waiting place before they are resurrected to be judged. There's not going to be any more need for Hades. That's gone too. Ultimately, Judgment Day is the day that every Christian longs for. That's what we long for. It's the fulfillment of the age-old promise that Jesus is coming back to take us with him, to be with him forever. It's the defeat of sin and death, and it's the life everlasting. We will stand before God and give an account of our lives, knowing that we will stand not in our own power, but in the power of the risen Son, Jesus Christ. And something cool as we read these passages from Revelation, even in our hymns from today, in our scripture reading for today, when we stand before God, when we live a life here on earth, Jesus says we are to build up treasures not here on earth. We don't want to stockpile gold and silver and dollar bills. We don't want to stockpile that. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. See, on that day, when we live our lives here and now for Jesus, when we give what we have to Jesus, we store up that treasure in heaven. And the Bible says in Revelation, when we are judged by our words and our deeds, not only the hidden sins that we have been forgiven of will be revealed, but also the works that we have done will be there as an offering to Jesus. There will be those who receive the crown of faithfulness. And then, as the song says, all the saints gathered around the throne will cast their crowns before the feet of Jesus. Because of him, we have eternal life. In Jesus, we will celebrate together as each name is read out of the book of life. It's going to be a celebration. It's going to be a celebration. All of us together, celebrating what Jesus has done. Celebrating what we have done together as the body of Christ. This is why we want to talk about this stuff. We want people to know Jesus, the one who fully and completely knows them and loves them more than anyone else ever could. If you know that one day Jesus will return and usher in full and everlasting life, why on earth, or heaven for that matter, why would you not want others to have that opportunity as well? This is why we look to heaven. This is why we talk about this, think about this. Not to speculate on when Jesus will return. Or to think, well, things will be great eventually one day, so I guess I'll just wait around to see that happen. Instead, we can live out Jesus' command to go and make disciples, invite people into a place where they can belong. We can show them a Jesus worth believing in. And ultimately, we want to become more like Jesus here and now. This heaven and hell conversation isn't just for the far future. It's something for here and now. Kevin DeYoung sums this up perfectly at the very end of his book, Just Do Something. The end of the matter is this: live for God, obey the scriptures, think of others more than yourself, be holy, love Jesus, and as you do these things, do whatever else you like, with whomever you like, wherever you like, and you will be walking in the will of God. Friends, let's do something. Let's go and share the good news of heaven, of Jesus, with those that we meet, so that one day we'll all stand together. We'll see each other on the other side. Amen? Would you pray with me? Father God, thank you again for the gift of eternal life that you give to us. A gift that we could never earn, that we could never, ever deserve, but one that you freely give to us. God, help us to live each day for you, not to earn your love, not to earn this salvation, not to earn our place, as it were, but because we've already got it. We've already got all of these in you. And because we are loved, because we are saved, because we are forgiven, how could we not? How could we not live our lives for you? How could we not give back to the one who's given us so much? Lord, give us strength, give us courage to live out this life for others. As difficult as it can be at times, help us to love others as you have loved us. Help us to show them a Jesus worth following. We love you, we praise you, and we await the coming kingdom. The day of days, the day when we will stand before our Creator and know that we are loved and cherished and forgiven. It's in your name we pray. Amen. We'll now receive our tithes and our offerings.
Let us confess our faith as we join in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. O Lord, we pray for healing and strength for all those in our congregation. We ask that you give them rest and that your healing hand would be upon them. We pray for Jean Evans, who has been released from the hospital to IOOF. We also pray for Irene Zook, who has been released from the hospital. Continue to restore them with your power, O God, and comfort all who struggle with an illness. Lord, in your mercy, eternal God, you made us in your own image and redeemed us through Jesus, your Son. Look with compassion on the whole human family. Take away the arrogance and hatred which infect our hearts. Break down the walls that separate us. Unite us in bonds of love, and through our struggles and confusion, work to accomplish your purposes on earth, that in your good time, all nations and races may serve you in harmony around your heavenly throne. Lord, in your mercy, Heavenly Father, we cannot name all for whom we wish to pray this day. Some are known only to one or two of us, some are known only to you. Yet we wish to place them all under your loving care. So together we pray for all who are named silently this moment by any in our midst. Bless them, surround them with your love, and perfectly provide for each one. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please join me in the singing of the Lord's Prayer.
Receive this benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give each and every one of you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thank you.